third major predictor of prognosis in this disease is called the stage of the disease. Stage refers to how this disease was picked up in the first place, and it's related to how much disease we think a person actually has.
If no cancer can be felt by a digital rectal examination, the cancer is called stage T1. If the biopsy was performed because of an elevated PSA, the stage is designated T1C. T1A or T1B are used to define patients whose cancer was found incidentally at the time of a procedure called a TURP or TURP. The TURP, or transurethral resection of the prostate, is done to open up blockage of the urethra caused by what's presumed to be a benign enlargement of the prostate gland. If, however, a person has a nodule or a small lump that we can feel, their cancer is considered a T2. T, once again, stands for tumor, and 2 means we can feel something. The designation T2A indicates there is tumor involving less than one half of one side of the gland. The designation T2B indicates that the tumor is extensively found involving one side of the gland. The designation T2C indicates that there is cancer felt on both sides of the gland. A T3 would be a tumor that is big, hard, and rocky within the gland, which has already broken outside of the gland according to what we feel with our fingers. The second way we assess the clinical stage is by the number of biopsies that actually show cancer. A person may be classified as having a stage T1C cancer because he has an elevated PSA. But when we do biopsies, he may have as little as one biopsy out of 12 that shows evidence of cancer. Or he may have 10 out of 12 that show cancer. In both situations, the patient would be classified as a stage T1C, but each clearly has differing amounts of disease. So this is a very important factor in discussing prognosis.
So, now we have a number of pieces of information about your particular case. We know your PSA, we know your Gleason score, we know the number of tissue samples that are positive from the biopsy, and we know what the clinical stage of the disease is. Using those pieces of information, we can begin to make an estimate of what the chances are that the cancer has already spread to other parts of the body.
Once again, we're trying to estimate the chances that the cancer may have spread to other parts of the body, such as the bone, or regionally to the lymph nodes, or just locally into the seminal vesicles and the tissues outside of the gland. These are important because evidence of spread can be an indication of how the cancer will respond to different treatments. Your physician will go over the estimated risks with you during your consultation. Depending on your PSA and biopsy results, your physician may want to order additional tests, specifically bone scans, CT scans, MRIs, prostatin scans, or perhaps PET scans may be appropriate.
Now, a bone scan is a test where a tiny amount of radioactive material is injected in the veins. The entire body is filmed shortly afterwards. Areas where cancer is growing in the bones will show up as intensely black on the scan.
CT scans can be used to identify enlarged lymph nodes. MRI scans may add additional information about spread of the disease beyond the capsule of the gland. The use of the endorectal coil gives a much enhanced image, and agents such as ferromagnetic particles are showing promise in finding cancer in the lymph nodes.
New technologies are being explored that may prove to enhance the usefulness of MR scans. One of these experimental approaches is called MR spectroscopy, or MRS. MRS combines the magnified images of the standard MR scan with information about the chemical activity within different portions of the prostate gland. Areas with cancer will have one chemical profile, while normal areas will have a different profile. Combining these two types of information may give a better picture of the amount of disease within the gland and how likely it is to have spread outside the prostate.
PET scanning using newer agents may also be useful.
In the near future, there will be more advanced ways of predicting whether or not the cancer has spread outside of the gland and how aggressive or slow growing these cancers may be. These areas of research include genetic microarrays that will evaluate each individual's cancer cells for specific genetic mutations or alterations that predict for aggressiveness. Circulating tumor cells that can measure even an extremely small amount of cancer cells in the blood. and new blood markers that are more specific than PSA. These tests, when and if they become available, will allow us to tailor treatment recommendations specifically based on the expected level of dangerousness of the disease, with greater accuracy than we can achieve using the PSA, stage, and Gleason score alone.